1963, World Food Program in India has signed MOU with Indian government, and in 1978 there was Alma-Ata declaration was there where the need for primary health care was recognized. In 1975 we see the umbrella scheme called Integrated Child Health Development Scheme was there. Under that, National Food Security Act and Poshan Abhiyan in 2017 was launched. These were some of the initiative by Indian government. Globally, the need for childcare has been recognized and various works have been done by international agencies and academicians as well. So we see the value is 144 million under 5 children, which is 21.3%. So talking about the objective of this paper, firstly, we'll examine and compare the height of Indian children with the WHO standard. And secondly, we'll study the birth weight patterning of stunted and non-stunted children. And thirdly, we'll analyze the overall growth pattern, distribution, and factors associated with stunting by age across the states of India. Talking about the methodology, we have taken two data sets. These are the sample size value. We have taken data from NFHS-4 and also from multicentric growth reference study. We have taken the WHO standard right from there. Talking about methodology, we did binary logistic regression to get the correlates, and dependent variable was stunting. It was assumed the value of 1 if the study population was stunted and 0 for not stunted and so on. And adjusted odds ratio from a logistic model were presented with 95% confidence interval. I'll be quickly coming into the findings. So the first finding is, you can see this graph, the x-axis is showing the age of the children in months, which is starting from 0 months and up to 59 months. And this y-axis is showing the mean height of Indian children. So this black line you see in this graph is showing the WHO standard, and this light blue bars are showing the mean height of Indian children across the ages. So you see the difference is very less if you see this initial period. This is, I'm talking about the mean height. The difference is very less in initial months, but as the after we see at 12 months, the difference is increasing, and it goes up to 10. The difference goes up to 10 centimeters, which is very high indeed. So this is the condition of height if we compare it to the WHO standard. Talking about gender difference, WHO has said that there should be gender difference even in an ideal condition. In the difference, there would be difference in the height of boy and height of girl. So in India also, we see the difference is not very much at initial years and so on. So there is not significant gender difference if we just see the mean height. Urban-rural difference, if we talk about urban-rural difference, WHO has said that there should not be any urban-rural difference in ideal condition in height of the children. But we see in India, we have some, it is very less, from 2 centimeters to 5 centimeters, but still there is some gender urban-rural difference at India level itself. So for this growth pattern and distribution, about the factors of stunting, we see these are the household characteristics. These are the variables taken into the consideration, mother's characteristics. And I'll be discussing about the significance one in household characteristics in our model. Wealth quintile obviously was one of the significant variable. Another was, if we talking about the mother's characteristics, height of the mother, education of the mother, pregnancy duration even, and ANC was significant ones. In child characteristics, birth weight and anemia was significant. Talking about birth weight, here is the birth weight patterning of stunted and non-stunted children. This graph is, you see this red dotted line is showing the birth weight of all stunted children, and this blue bars are showing the birth weight of non-stunted children. So you see right from the birth, they are having the lower birth weight, and they are supposed to be stunted also. So we need to address this composite nature of these stunting and wasting together. Bifurcating this age gradient thing, we see this black dotted line is showing the WHO standard. So we see almost all of the Indian states are doing well. They are almost up to the WHO standard level, and some of them are even bigger than that. But as long as we come to the age 3 months, this is just in months. That was the graph which is above is height at age 0 months, and next one is height at age 3 months. We see most of the states are lagging behind, and this gap increases as we go on until 59 months of age. So mother's height was one of the significant characters, significant factors. So we see here the mother's height of Meghalaya, which is lowest, 148.4 centimeter, which might give the reason behind the highest prevalence of stunting in Meghalaya among all the northeastern states and so on. And Bihar also we see at the lower side, if we talk about the median height of the mother. And at a higher side, we see Jammu, Kashmir, Punjab, Kerala, Haryana, and so on is there. Talking about the regional variation of stunting, so we see it is very obvious central part of India is doing not very well. Stunting is very high across all the age groups. I have divided it in 0 to 5 months and 6 to 11 months and so on. So in central India, it is higher. And in southern Indian states are doing well with lower percent, lower prevalence of stunting across all the age groups. Quickly coming to the conclusion of the study. So nutritional status of children, particularly the prevalence of stunting in India, remains major public health concern. With limited data and time for analysis, the study, however, could explore certain fundamental issues. And in addition to policies and programs, improving in maternal and child nutrition equal focus should be given to improving mothers' education as well and so on. Among all stunted children, UP has the highest share, followed by Bihar, MP and Maharashtra. And these states have more than 50% share of stunted children. So we see this Central India thing. Of course, there were some of the limitations of this study, as we see that the data was taken from NFHS thing. So NFHS is not a dedicated nutrition survey. So they provide limited data for children and mothers' diet. So regarding the selection of determinants of stunting, mother's height and BMI were taken as the proxy for mother's nutrition. Also, children height at birth. Birth weight is taken but in the NFHS data, but height at birth was not collected. Data was not available by actual measurement. Instead of that, perceived height of the children at birth was considered, which was small, very small, large, and very large, which is, we cannot include that thing in our analysis and so on. So this height at birth thing should be collected. If it is possible at all. Another limitation was there were some questions on this WHO growth standard as well. As we see some northern European countries, they say that height of 0 to 5 year old appeared to be larger than the supposedly ideal heights according to WHO growth standard. So questioning the universal applicability of the WHO growth standard. So these were some of the limitations. Further research question, we see that present WHO standard might become outdated or less comparable in the near future due to a secular change in height. So what would be the standard to compare? It came in 2008 itself and now it is 2021. So what would be the standard to compare if this secular change thing is happening? And also how to minimize the intergenerational effect of stunting? So about policy recommendation, we see that stunting is not something we can minimize.
You have to wrap it up, please. You have crossed the time limit also. Thank you very much. Policy recommendations are there.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
These are the references and all. Thank you.
Thank you, Diksha. And now we have next presentation, association between gender inequality and maternal, neonatal and child health. Presenter is Yuvraj Krishnamurthy.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, please start your presentation. Now it's going to be 4:05. So at 4:15, you have to stop it.
Yeah, sure, ma'am. You can see the slides, ma'am.
Yes.
So good evening, everyone. So I'm Dr. Yuvraj, assistant professor from EFSA Medical College, Chennai. So the topic that I'm going to present is on association between gender inequality and maternal, neonatal and child health. It's a pooled analysis of data from 160 countries. So first, a brief introduction. Gender equality in terms of health, we can tell it as an achievement of equivalent health outcomes in both male and females. And it is also an important indicator for with respect to healthcare also for a country, as it largely affects the maternal and child health of mother and children. And also the existing policies and program focuses mostly on the morbidities with respect to reproductive and sexual health and doesn't go beyond this health needs. Hence, what we did is that we tried to study the association between gender inequality and various maternal, neonatal, and child health indicators throughout the world. So the study design, what we adapted is an ecological study. What we did is like we took aggregate data of individual countries and we tried to analyze with exposure as gender inequality and outcome as all the maternal, neonatal, and child health indicators. So with respect to the data sources, first the exposure gender inequality index, we took from the UNDP 2017 data. This is a composite indicator. It consists of three components. First is the reproductive health, under which maternal mortality rate and adolescent marriage rate will be counted. And then women empowerment, which is in terms of parliamentary seat share, as well as the women who are completing the secondary education. And then the labor market, that is the labor participation rate. And this index ranges from 0 to 1, with 1 indicating a perfect inequality, that is 100% inequality, while 0 indicating there is no inequality. Next is the outcome variables. So the sources of these outcome variables, that is maternal, neonatal, and child health, were taken from various sources like WHO Global Health Observatory, UNICEF, and the World Bank Data Repository. So with respect to maternal, we took antenatal care coverage, stillbirth attendance, postnatal care, all the service coverage indicators, and the morbidity indicators like low birth weight, stunting, underweight, and then mortality indicators like infant mortality, neonatal, and under 5 mortality. So coming to the statistical analysis, we performed the analysis using Stata software. And first, what we did is we tried to see the correlation between the gender inequality index and all these outcome indicators. We used BMN correlation as the data followed a non-normal distribution. Then we assessed the association between these indicators using something called a robust regression, as the data had more of outliers, as well as there was heteroscedasticity, which is a basic assumption for ordinary least square regression. Since it was violated, it was performed with the robust regression, except for two outcomes, that is stillbirth attendance and antenatal care coverage. So for these two outcomes alone, we performed something called instrument variable regression, because there is a chance of simultaneity bias. As I already told, in gender inequality index, one of the domain is having a maternal mortality rate. So there is a chance of reverse causality between these two exposure and outcome. Hence, we performed instrument variable regression, keeping domestic violence and adolescent marriage rate as instrument variable, and performed the analysis. We also performed the multivariable analysis, adjusting for a potential confounder. Only for one confounder we adjusted, that is the GDP per capita of the country. Now coming to the results, first this table shows just a descriptive of a gender inequality index across different WHO regions and HTA regions. Here we can see that most of the those African countries and Southeast Asian countries are having poorer gender inequality. And similarly, with respect to HTA region, you can see that when the HTA goes down, there is an increase in the gender inequality. So this table shows the correlation between the gender inequality index and the different indicators. Here we can see that all the indicators have been significantly correlated with the maternal and neonatal health indicators. We can see that with respect to service coverage indicators like ANC coverage, stillbirth attendance, and postnatal care, with the increase in the gender inequality, there is a decrease in the coverage, service coverage indicators. With respect to morbidity indicators and mortality indicators, we can see that with the increase in the gender inequality, there is an increase in this neonatal mortality rate or low birth weight. Similarly, we see the correlation with respect to the child health indicators as well. Now coming to the association, here also we can see that there has been a significant association with respect to all the maternal, neonatal, and the child health indicators in both unadjusted as well as in adjusted beta coefficient, with the highest association was seen for PNC care for mothers as well as newborns, where we can see that even a 0.01 unit increase in gender inequality index of a country increases the decreases the postnatal care coverage by about 1%. Similarly, with respect to the child health indicators, here also we can see that all the morbidity, mortality, and service coverage indicators have a significant association with gender inequality index, even after adjusting for the GDP per capita of the country. Here also we can see that the maximum association was seen with the underweight, where even a 0.01 unit increase in gender inequality will increase the underweight rate by 0.85. So coming to the discussion, so we saw that higher the gender inequality index, we saw higher is the morbidity and mortality, and lesser is the service coverage for mothers and children. And also the association maintained across the region. When we did the subgroup analysis also, it was higher in all the regions, especially in the low and low middle income countries. And these findings were also in line with the previous studies, which showed a significant association between gender inequality index and maternal and child health indicators. However, there are some limitations in our study. As with any other ecological study, there is a possibility of ecological fallacy, as we are trying to infer group results into an individual population. And there can also be underreporting of data because we took data from various sources like the World Bank repository and the WHO repositories, where the countries may tend to over report the service coverage or underreport their morbidity or mortality. So to conclude, still in spite of those limitations, we can see that there is a negative impact of gender inequality on morbidity, mortality and service utilization of both mother and children. And also we saw in subgroup analysis, we also saw that the maximum impact was seen in the African and Southeast Asian region countries. So any national policies and legislation should target not only the women's health, but also the comprehensive women care, that is women welfare, that is education, employment and political empowerment. Thank you.
Madam Chairman, can I present? I'm ready.
Thank you, Krishnamurthy. You have presented within time. Professor Lumdim, you wanted to present now?
Avinash, yeah, please upload. Yeah.
Yes, you can present.
Okay. Good afternoon to all of you. Unfortunately, the first author, Mr. Strong Marbanian, he just called 45 minutes ago that there is no electricity in the whole of the city of Shillong. So we prepared that hurriedly. Nevertheless, this is a co-author paper, and I will try to do justification to whatever he has done. As you all know, the title of the paper or the of this particular seminar for which we have identified is the effect of maternal height on the risk of cesarean section in singleton birds, evidence from the large-scale survey in India. See the next, please. The idea behind this or the background is that we find that C-section or the cesarean section, which is a surgical procedure, can effectively prevent maternal and newborn mortality when used for medically indicated reasons. And we find that despite the fact that the WHO give a kind of a range where the cesarean section should be permitted or limited to about 10 to 15, but we find that in many of the countries, particularly even in India, as well as China and others, we find that it is sometimes almost double or triple the percentage or the value which WHO recommends. So we find that the use of cesarean section is unabated, and sometimes people use it as a contraceptive method, in the sense citing the complications that the woman is going to face. So the hypothesis behind this particular paper is that we are trying to look at this association between the height of the maternal height as well as the tendency to go for this C-section. As you can see, next please. There are many papers that are also already available in which they try to associate, or they try to give the reason why C-section is correlated more with the height of the woman. So, for example, the short adult height is a sign of the growth of retardation, which is particularly indication of the nutrition in low and middle income countries. Perkin and others have cited them, and also studies indicate that the mean pelvic area of tall females is greater than those of median and short stature women. Therefore, there is a difference in terms of the giving birth or opting for the C-section. Then short stature women of narrow pelvis area are related to obstructed labor. through which the head of the or the shoulder of the baby is hindered. So that also gives you leads to complications, sometimes even to the maternal mortality. On the other hand, tall women of wider pelvis area have easier childbirth and higher birth weight babies. Both factors which reduce infant and maternal mortality. Next, please. So the as I said, the hypothesis behind is that that not all of the C-sections are at the critical or the complicated level, but sometimes you will find that there are suggestions or advice from the doctors also to go for C-section. But if you look at the demographic data, there is very much a correlation between short stature as well as the even women who are taller than the average height of, let's say, 150 to 151 or 55 centimeter, we also found that they are also going for the C-section, despite the fact that for them the vaginal birth would have been easily performed. So why this is important is to look at the previous studies. India have acknowledged the risk of the CS delivery in terms of maternal malnutrition, place of childbirth, healthcare accessibility. So in this case also, we are taking the average or the mean height. Next, please. As 150 to this one, and we try to compare the two, where the C-section is more likely to be higher. So that is where the logistic regression is being attempted. So the first objective is to determine the association between maternal height with the link of risk of the CS delivery. Then we use the NFHS data. We include only this 251,000 single births to mothers between those who are 120 centimeter to 180 centimeter. Then next, this is the first result. Avinash, next.
Avinash, Lumnim sir have disconnected or what? Avinash?
Yes ma'am. He is present actually, but his sound is not audible.
Sound is not coming. No? His sound is
yeah, yes sir.
Call him.
Yes.
Hello.
Yeah. Yeah. I think I'm back now. I'm back now. Okay. Thank you. Yeah. So, unfortunately, I have to switch the network also. Now I am on the phone data. Okay. Avinash, the first. Okay. This is the first result. Again. Okay, I'm trying to limit by that 10 minutes. I hope I'm not going to cross more than 1-2 minutes. So this is the first result that shows if you look at the height on the left, the y-axis, you will see that half of those were less than 150 to 151 centimeter. That is the average height. You'll see that the odds or the probability of going for cesarean delivery are much higher. It is, some of them are going beyond three times the odds of, or the likelihood of going for CS compared to those who are taller women, starting from, let's say, 152 onwards up to 180 centimeter. Next, please. Okay, make it bigger. Yeah, this is simply to show that if we look at the chances, or the, you will see that overall maternal height, this is simply showing that with maybe with 1 centimeter increase in the maternal height, the likelihood of the or reduction in the cesarean section is just about 0.2%. Okay, so this is just to give an idea that if we have circled a few of those which are related to the height as well as the BMI of the mothers. If you take the combination of, for example, compared to those who are normal in terms of height and in terms of BMI, you'll see that it is more than the chances are much higher with short height, normal BMI, as well as short height overweight, or short height with obesity. With obesity, it is almost three times the likelihood of going for similarly with the child birth weight. If we compare with the those who are less than 4.5 kilos compared to more than that. Just go down a little bit. Then in case of place of delivery also, those who are in the private health center are more likely to, and that is quite as per the expectation. Okay, next please. So this is just three graphs trying to show how the results when we are taking by the age of the woman, as well as the parity, and also by the birth weight. So you'll see that the for those who are taller women, you will see that the graph shows that they are less going for the C-section. Next. So the conclusion which the first author suggests is that since even the tall women are going for CS, despite the fact that they have less chances of complication, those tall women also should be counseled that they don't go for cesarean section, because cesarean section can lead to many complications. Therefore, the message is that the unless essential or unless very necessary cesarean section delivery can be avoided, in which the women are counseled as well as it become a policy for the government. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Abhinav, thank you. I think you have not crossed much time. Thank you for that. And now I will invite, I have a pressure to complete as well and start the plenary session. That's why I am going fast, little fast. Immediately after this, we have plenary session. Aparna is there? Aparna? Fourth presenter? Aparna B? Okay, if she is not around, then Viswajit Bisra? I think you... Viswajit Bisra?
Yes, ma'am. Am I audible?
Please start your presentation.
Okay. Can I have the sharing rights?
Abhinash will give, our ICT unit will give.
Yes, sir. Yes. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Is the PowerPoint slide visible?
Yes, very much.
Okay. Good evening, all. I'm here to present my research on age-appropriate immunization scenario in Jharkhand. Okay. So as we all know that children health status is very crucial as it affects each and every phase of the life, not only the child, but also the family and the nation as well. So as per WHO, immunization is a proven and cost-effective method to avert life-threatening infectious disease and is expected to prevent 2 to 3 million casualties every year. With this in mind, the expanded program on immunization was started in 1978 with an objective to reduce morbidity, mortality, and disabilities from 6 serious but vaccine-preventable diseases, which are tuberculosis, diphtheria, pertussis, tetanus, polio, and measles. Further, child immunization is determined by several factors, which can be of individual level, family or community level, or health system or service delivery levels. So coming to the point that what is age-appropriate immunization? So age-appropriate immunization implies that the children receive all the vaccines within recommended age intervals and on time. Because of which maximum immunity is not done too early. So the study focuses on the state of Jharkhand. It was created as a new state out of Bihar in the year 2000 with a population of 32 million as per Census of India, Census 2011, of which 26% is tribal population. The state of healthcare was very low at the time of formation of Jharkhand, but significant improvements have been made in improving the full immunization coverage of the children. In 1998, only 8% of the children aged 12 to 23 months were fully immunized, which rose to 61.9% in 2014 and 15. So the specific objective of the studies are
in between his sound is going. There is a problem from his side or from our side? Biswajit? Biswajit?
Ma'am, I think it's some problem from his side because otherwise everybody seems to be okay.
Avinash? Avinash, you are around?
Madam, I will talk to Avinash.
Okay, please talk to him and
hello, huh? Yes, sound is not.
Sound is not coming. I think he disconnected or he got disconnected or network must have gone. Because there is no sound and nothing is moving. So, but in within 1 or 2 minutes, he will not join. Then we will disconnect this and start the next one. Aparna is joined now. I think Aparna is joined. Aparna was not there when I have called her name.
Yes, ma'am.
Huh? There was a problem for you to join this session? And what was there?
Ma'am, I lost in between, so I didn't connect.
So you start, Aparna, you start the presentation. Abhinash, you share the link to Aparna. If he will be, if he is joining again, then we will start for Biswajit. Yeah, please start.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Good evening, everyone. My topic is effect of maternal nutrition and socioeconomic factors on child nutrition in India. Next slide. Okay, introduction. Malnutrition is a state of over or undernutrition, and its consequences on maternal and child health are very alarming. Maternal nutrition plays an important role in improving the health of mothers and their children, and also offered healthy growth of newborn infants. Maternal malnutrition is the prime cause of mortality and morbidity in children below 5 years of age. Despite a fast-growing economy and the largest anti-malnutrition program, India has the world's worst level of child malnutrition. As per Global Nutrition Report 20, sir, next slide. As per Global Nutrition Report 2020, India is the country with the largest number of children who are stranded and wasted, and also more than 1 million children had otherwise. In India, 1 in 2 women and 1 in 5 women who enter pregnancy are anemic or undernourished respectively. The influence of maternal nutrition on the health and the survival of children are exceptionally high during the first 5 years of life. The objective of my study the effect of maternal nutrition and socioeconomic factors on the nutritional status of children under 5 years of age. And methodology used. Data from the fourth round of NFHS survey were used for the study. Interviews were completed among 247,733 mothers whose last born child below 5 years of age were not surveyed. Methodologies used, univariate and bivariate distribution tables were used to analyze various socioeconomic and other characteristics of the mothers and children. Chi-square and logistic regression analysis were also done for the detailed and in-depth study. Findings of the study. So next, predictive variables included are community level factors such as place of residence and region. Socioeconomic factors such as religion, caste, household wealth index, and maternal educational level. Maternal factors that included age at birth. Nutritional factors such as height for age, weight for height, BMI, and anemia levels. Other factors that were included were place of birth and time of initiation of breastfeeding activity. The dependent variables included height for age, weight for height, and weight for age of children below 5 years of age. So next, this is the univariate analysis. In case of community level factors, the highest proportion of mothers were found in rural and central region. Considering socioeconomic factors, greater proportion of mothers were found in the Hindu region, obesity groups, and mothers from poor households and who had secondary education. While considering the maternal factors, highest proportion of mothers were among 25 to 29 age group, and more than half of the total mothers were too short for their height. Only 15% and 47% of the total mothers had normal height for their age and normal weight for their height respectively, and about 65% had normal BMI. More than 55% of the total mothers were anemic at some sort. More than half of the total children were born in public hospitals, and nearly 44% had been injured breastfeeding within 1 hour of birth. About 58% of the children were severely morbidly stranded, while nearly 44% of the total children were severely morbidly wasted, and more than 70% of the total children were severely morbidly underweight. The results of bivariate analysis, around 60% or more than 60% of the total children born to mothers of rural areas, central and eastern region were either severely or moderately stranded. About 46% and 41% of the total children born to mothers of rural areas and western region had normal weight for their height. Nearly 41% and 38% of the total children born to mothers from Muslim religious groups and SA or ST groups had normal height for their age. Rest of the children were either severely or moderately stranded. Around 46% and 41% of the total children born to mothers from Hindu religious groups and ST ethnic groups had normal weight for their height. Only 34% and 32% of the total children born to mothers from the poor household and the low level of education had normal height for their age. Table 1 shows the prevalence of standing and wasting in children in relation to mothers. Only 33% only 33% and 46% of the total children born to mothers of 45 to 49 age group had normal height for age and normal weight for height respectively. The column represents the the bracket represents the column percentage and the star represents the equal level of 1%. So next. The next shape 2.1 and 2.2 shows the prevalence of standing and wasting in children in relation to maternal and nutritional factors. About 65% and 55% of the total children born to severely stranded mothers were severely or moderately stranded and wasted respectively. Nearly 70% and 65% of the total children born to severely wasted mothers were severely or moderately stranded and wasted respectively. More than half of the total severely or moderately stranded and wasted children were born to severely stranded and wasted mothers. Severely stranded mothers. So next 2.2. In case of BMI level, only 34% and 36% of the total children born to mothers who were underweighted has normal height for age and weight for height respectively. While maternal anemia is considered, the same proportion. The same proportion is 38% and 42% respectively. Table 3 shows the prevalence of standing and wasting in children in relation with the place of birth and time of initial breastfeeding up to the delivery. More than half of the total severely or moderately stranded and wasted children were born in public hospitals. Nearly 53% of the children who had initial breast milk within 1 hour of birth were severely or moderately stranded and wasted. Table 4 shows the prevalence of underweight in children in relation to community level factors. Around 27% and 35% of the children born to rural and urban mothers had normal weight for age. Rest of the children were either severely or moderately underweighted. Of the total severely and moderately underweighted children, the highest proportion among them were born to mothers from central region. So next, table 5 shows the prevalence in relation to religion and caste. Children born to Christian mothers and other ethnic groups had comparatively better weight status than those of other categories. So next. Table 6 shows the percentage distribution of children by their weight status according to household wealth index and maternal education. Only 22% and 21% of the total children born to mothers from poor household and who had no level of education had normal weight for their age. So next. Table gives the percentage distribution of children by their weight status according to mother's age. Nearly 80% of the total children born to mothers of 45 to 49 age group were severely or moderately underweight. So next. Table 8.1 and 8.2 gives the percentage distribution of children by their weight status according to maternal nutritional factors. More than 60% of the severely underweighted children were born to severely stranded mothers. Of the total children born to severely wasted mothers, only 17% had normal weight for their age and more than half were severely underweighted. So next. Underweighted mothers had the highest proportion of severely underweighted children, that is 54%. Highest proportion of severely underweighted children were born to mildly anemic mothers. Sir, next. Table 9 gives the percentage distribution of children by their weight status according to place of birth and the time of first breastfeeding after delivery. About 28% of the children born in public hospitals had normal weight for their age, whereas in private hospitals, it is 36%. Higher proportion of severely or moderately underweighted children had the initial breast milk within 1 day of birth. All the predictive variables used in the second stage of bivariate analysis showed significant association with the dependent variables under chi-square test and hence considered for third stage of logistic regression analysis. So next. Fourth stage of logistic regression analysis explaining the effect of maternal, socioeconomic, and nutritional factors on nutritional status of children in India. Exponential beta 1, exponential beta 2, and exponential beta 3 gives the adjusted odds ratio of for standing, wasting, and underweight of children respectively. When rural mothers were observed, the chances of their children to be stranded, wasted, and underweighted were respectively 3%, 9%, and 8% higher than their corresponding reference category. Comparing with the reference religion, the others had 9% more chance to be stranded. As per the reference caste, children of mothers belonging to OBC group had 1% chance to be wasted. In case of wealth index, children of mothers from rich category had 22%, 13%, and 24% lesser chance to be stranded, wasted, and underweighted respectively when compared to the corresponding reference categories. With reference to mothers having no education, children of mothers who had attained higher education had 40%, 16%, and 38% lesser chance to be stranded, wasted, and underweighted respectively, while they were 0.4% and 1% higher chance for the children of mothers who had only primary education to be wasted and underweighted respectively. Sir, previous slide, please. Considering the age of mother. Sir, please. Hello? Hello?
What do you want?
Sir, previous one, not this one, table 10.
Just close this, close your presentation as early as possible.
Okay, ma'am. It's about 20. No, sir, previous one. Fine, thank you. Considering the age of mothers, the children of mothers in the 40 to 50 age group had the highest chance to be stranded, that is 22%. The children of mothers at higher ages have higher chance of stranding with respect to the reference age group. Further, the chances of becoming stranding increases with the age. The children of mothers in the 30 to 34 age group had the highest chance to be wasted. Children born to mothers in the 40 to 44 age group had times higher chance to be underweighted than the children born to reference age group. Sir, next. Sir, next one. Next slide. Okay, thank you. This one. Compared to severely stranded mothers, children born to normal mothers had 51%, 11%, and 43% less chance to be stranded, wasted, and underweighted respectively. As per the severely wasted mothers, children born to normal mothers had 35%, 39%, and 48% lesser chance to be stranded, wasted, and underweighted. With reference to underweighted mothers, children of obese mothers had the least chance to be stranded, wasted, or underweighted. Considering the severely anemic mothers, children of not anemic mothers had 11% lesser chance to be wasted, while children of moderately anemic had 3% higher chance to be underweighted. With reference to home, children born in public and private hospitals had 8% and 13% lesser chance to be. Sir, it's not finished. Okay. 8% and 13% lesser chance to be stranded. While considering the children who had their first breastfeeding within 1 hour, those who had within 24 hours had 4%, 3%, and 7% highest chance to be stranded, wasted, or underweighted. Then place of residence had significant association with the stranding of children. Anemia level of mothers had no significant association with the stranding or underweight, whereas less significant association with wasting of children. Place of birth had no significant association with wasting of children. The rest, all predictive variables had highly significant association with all the three dependent variables. Next comes summary. More than 80% and 50% of the total children were severely or moderately stranded and wasted respectively. Underweight children is no significant size growth failure in India. More than 50% of the total children were stranded or wasted. Children from South India had comparatively better nutritional status than those from other regions. Only 34% and 36% of the total children born to underweighted mothers had normal height for each and weight for height respectively. 67% and 79% of the total children born to mothers in the 45 to 49 age group were stranded and underweighted respectively. So next.
Close it. Now Biswajit is there. Biswajit, you want to start from the where you have left, and you take.
I think I'll begin from the methodology part.
Forget about methodology. You start with findings.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, ma'am. I'd like to apologize for the internet bandwidth. So we can see this is the first result. We can see the coverage of different vaccines.
We cannot see your PowerPoint presentation. You have to open it up again.
Okay, okay. The PowerPoint presentation. 1 minute. Share. Now is it visible?
Now it is started.
So this is my first result where we can see that the coverage of different vaccine and what portion of that coverage was age appropriate and what was delayed. So we can see that even though there's the coverage is fairly good, age appropriate vaccination is comparatively less in Jharkhand. So these are the bivariate relationship between this. So first is we have the individual vaccines, and then we have 1:3:1 vaccination that is age appropriate full immunization. That means that all the children have been fully immunized and that too in age appropriate manner. So we can see that the males are having slightly edge over females in having full male child are having edge over female child in having full vaccination, age appropriate vaccination. Further, with birth order, with increase in birth order, age appropriate vaccination decreases, and with increase in mother's educational attainment, we see that age appropriate immunization increases. For next, we see that if a child is born in home, if a child is born in a health facility, they have a higher rate of age appropriate immunization. This is the result for age appropriate full immunization with respect to different background characteristics. So with a higher birth order, we see that there is with higher birth order, there is significant chances that they will have lower chances or lower odds of having age appropriate full immunization. Further, with a mother having secondary education, the chances, the odds of getting age appropriate full immunization increases. And similarly, if a child is born in public facility, the odds of getting age appropriate full immunization is 1.4 times higher than that of children born in home. So the major finding is that with years, full immunization coverage has increased from 8% in NFHS 2 to 62% in NFHS 4. But as mentioned earlier, vaccine is most effective if it is administered within the prescribed times. While full immunization shows remarkable progress, but age appropriate immunization presents a different picture of child health care. With only 27% of children in age group 12 to 23 months have received all basic vaccination in appropriate time. Factors like sex of the child, birth order, mother's education attainment, place of delivery plays a prominent role in age appropriate immunization of the child. So concluding that age appropriate immunization and immunization coverage are good indicators of healthcare service for children. This study clearly reveals that there is delay in immunization, which is very important for the child to develop immunity, especially for the vaccine preventable diseases. Immunization coverage can be improved by acting upon the factors which affect immunization, such as education of mother, delivery, increasing delivery in health institution. And the focus should not only be in introducing a new program, but proper implementation, governing it by maintaining its standard and efficiency. These are the references. Thank you.
Thank you. So now next presenter, Surabhi. Surabhi, you are there?
Yes,
Sumila, ma'am. Surabhi.
Yes, ma'am.
Don't take more time. So
yes, ma'am.
Then discussant will come and there will be questions.
Okay, ma'am. Is my slides visible? Are my slides visible?
It is visible, but what you have to do, go to PowerPoint and make it PowerPoint this thing presentation.
Okay, ma'am. Now, this is a review study to understand the impact of COVID-19 on adolescents in India. To start with the current updates of COVID-19, as per the statistics of WHO globally, 119 million confirmed cases are there, and more than 2.5 million deaths have occurred. America has reported the highest number of confirmed cases, followed by Europe and Southeast Asia. While in India, as on 15th March, confirmed cases were 11 million with more than 1.5 lakh of deaths. However, as per Indian dashboard, there are more than 2 lakh active cases. With the with respect to vaccination, as per 13th March globally, the almost 392 vaccination doses have been administered, while in India, cumulative coverage as per 15th March, 29 million coverage has been done. The age stratification shows that there is high prevalence of COVID-19 in the age group of 21 to 30 years and less in children and adolescents. Many studies from China, Europe, England, and combined studies have been conducted, but they have not been able to show that there can be a high prevalence among adolescents. In US also, one study could not show. However, there are two studies, that is Georgia overnight and summer 2020 studies, both from South Asia, which concluded that children of all ages are susceptible to COVID-19, and prevalence of COVID-19 in adolescents was significantly greater than in adults. In addition to these two studies, there is a large South Korean epidemiological study which shows that there is high prevalence of COVID-19 among adolescents, and they are quite capable of transmitting COVID-19 to others. Now, prevalence of data for adolescents is important, as it has implications for school reopenings in middle school and beyond. These are the impacts of COVID-19 on adolescents. With this background, research was initiated and 50 studies were found, 34 global, 16 India. They were mostly review articles, original articles, which had done online survey. They were news articles, reports. And all these studies, majority of the studies were done to see the impact of COVID-19 on the mental health status of adolescents. Now to see the effect of on malnutrition. As per CNS data, it is shown that adolescents are thin, and it is reiterated with the very recent NFHS survey. So the COVID-19 situation is certain to impact the food, nutrition, and health security. It indirectly impacts the disruption of programs like ICDS and midday meal, making more rural adolescents vulnerable and amplifying the situations of food insecurity. In India, there is no data or evidence to show direct impact of COVID-19 on nutritional status of adolescents. Now, on access to healthcare activities, with the onset of coronavirus, health system was involved with the preparedness and management of COVID-19, because of which delivery, utilization, and coverage of other health services was hampered. Therefore, in this case, NGOs came first. They were able to made aware of the difficulties in assessing services and supplies following the imposition of the lockdown by the adolescents themselves regarding the following health services. And the NGOs, they alerted health authorities, assisted health authorities in distribution of supplies. They trained girls in hygienic use of cloth during menstruation, procured and distributed supplies, provided necessary counseling to the community. Then they, besides those, they promoted behavior change and enforced preventive practices such as hand washing, social distancing, wearing masks. And they engaged adolescents in mask making, leveraged with existing network of peer educators. They also displayed hoardings and wall paintings. Besides this, they also supported migrant females by supplying sanitary napkins to them. The government came later after many reminders and demand from adolescents. The necessary services were again initiated and sanitary napkins were included in the essential list. Now on the education and learning outcomes, India was the first country to close down the schools from March 16, and an online learning system was initiated, which necessitated the use of smartphones and internet, which that imposed a big challenge of unavailability of smartphones and computers, unreliable internet connection, if at all, lack of technological skills and lack of electricity. Other consequences were negative consequences. Midday meal was disclosed, loss of friendship network, no access to opportunities to play and meet friends, higher incidence of dropouts. This higher incidence of dropout was also supported by United Nations of report, and this dropout is more, it is higher among girls. The Government of India released a guideline, Pragyata, for online education, and a Diksha platform was created where all the state and union territories could do the online education. Andaman and Nicobar, they used the Doordarshan network. Andhra Pradesh, they used YouTube and toll-free numbers for their online education. For the midday meal, Union Minister of HRD announced that the midday meal will be provided to students during the lockdown and subsequent summer. So it was given to all. In addition, Bihar released all the pending scholarships to adolescents, and West Bengal, along with the MDM kit, it supplied masks and soap. So NGOs, with all the support, they also looked into the threat of school discontinuation of the girls, and they tried counseling parents, informed school teachers, and also informed other authorities like frontline functionaries, PRI, and community large and community about the situation. Now on the mental health, a high amount of information floated on social media, significant proportions of which were unverified or false, which led to anxiety, depression, sleep disturbances, and loss of appetite among the adolescents. It posed and there was a big challenge to identify these adolescents who were undergoing these kind of mental stress. Now here, Government of India started a program Manodarpan, where they launched toll-free helpline and a website, and they also launched a handbook, which was issued on the life skills necessary to survive a health crisis. They also had psychological support units known as NEHI. They used RKSK platform in the containment areas. Teleconsultation was done through adolescent-friendly health clinics. NGOs, they were working in their own project area, so they were able to identify these adolescents who were undergoing mental stress. They became aware of boys and girls who were contemplating suicide, and during their field staff and adolescent interaction, fear were expressed by adolescents about the possibility of their own death or the death of a family member. Therefore, extended counseling services were done, and they were also counseled the migrant who was stranded at quarantine centers along with other people to keep their mindset positive. Now on the lifestyle that is reduced, what was the impact of COVID-19 on the lifestyle, that is reduced activity and increased screen time? There is just two study which shows that a mean sleep duration increased from 6 hours to 8 hours, average screen time increased from 5 hours to 3 hours. No, sorry, it increased to 5 hours from 3 hours, increased food intake, physical activity decreased as per self-monitoring, and ophthalmic issues arised. Therefore, to conclude my study, to have a stable environment, various stakeholders like central, state, NGOs, and private sectors need to work together to alleviate the severe impact of India's young population. Some issues related to adolescent can be addressed by utilizing community-based activities and clinical services under existing national adolescent programs, involving peer educators as a part of COVID-19 related information dissemination in the community is most recommended. And research is also needs to be done to determine the longer term impact of the pandemic on the adolescent behavior and to identify effective strategies to support families in the post COVID-19 context. Thank you.
Thank you, Sumila. Now I request Praveen to give his comment on the papers. Then there are few questions which are raised for specific presenters. We will allow them to answer those things.
Thank you for giving this opportunity. Let me first take this chance to congratulate all the, I think, 6 or 7 presenters for making very excellent presentations. I think the topics chosen were very appropriate to the theme, and they have addressed some of the very important questions. So let me start with the first presenter, Ms. Diksha. I think she did her paper on age-wise pattern of growth among Indian children, and she was looking at some of the correlates. I think it's important for us to understand, because there are different set of children of different age groups, so they face different challenges. So I think this was a important study, because normally we see that typically we look at children in a group like less than 5 or less than 3, but I think this was a good attempt to look at age disaggregate pattern of growth among children. So I find this study to be very interesting, and I think I just want the authors to maybe when they were looking at for instance, they were trying to explain the regional variations with regard to nutritional outcome among children of different cohorts. So maybe if they can talk more about, for instance, if you look at northeastern states or southern states as compared to the central states of India, where the burden of undernutrition is high. So if they can pinpoint, some area specific issues, for example, why in the northeastern states or southern states, because we know that undernutrition is just not the problem of deficiency of the quality of diet, but also a problem of understanding of, what a good diet is all about. You see, so and we also know a lot of research that tells us that there's plenty of items or food items available to people, but even among most learned people or most wealthiest people also, we find that the burden of undernutrition among children is quite significant. So if you can, I don't know if the data, how much data allows you to do that, but if you can try, if you want to publish this research, I think it will be very good if you focus on some of these important explanations, maybe, because otherwise the paper looks very good to me. It's just that if you can just focus, I just want the paper to be more focused, because you have done so much of work, so much of analysis, and there are few stories that you can bring out from the paper, because age stratification is very good. Because I'm also a geographer, so I'm inclined toward understanding these regional differences and what factors might explain. So maybe if you can throw light on that, it will be excellent. Otherwise, I think it looks very good to me. Second paper was,
So
second paper by Dr. Yuvraj Krishnamurthy, again, he chose a very important theme of addressing gender inequality and how that is associated with, broader umbrella of maternal and child health issues. I think that is a very, very novel attempt, looking at a global scenario. The indicator which you used for, generating this gender inequality index is quite, well selected, and I appreciate you for that. And you have also used good methods to look at, how gender inequality is associated with, mortality, maternal healthcare utilizations. So I think it's a pretty good attempt, and I think this paper can really go for good publication. So I don't have any critique over this paper. I just wonder, if one can also do similar kind of study for India at a disaggregated level. Or maybe a second paper, you can think about doing it at India level, and think if you can do with NFHS 4 or maybe 5, that will be a very good contribution. So congratulations to you, Dr. Yuvraj.
Thank you, sir.
By Professor Lungding, sir, first of all, I express my sincere regards and greeting to Professor Lungding, my teacher. I think this paper is also very interesting, where, the first author and Professor Lungding together are addressing very important issue of C-section deliveries in India. I think in the last 10, 15 years, this issue has really caught attention of one and all. And typically, particularly, if you look at the MTP Act, the idea was basically, and recently I was just reading paper today, that this MTP Act is now being further modified in the parliament, and there's been some discussion going on. So when this act came, it was actually for women to help them to decide, whether they want to continue with the pregnancy which has some problem or not, or if there is any difficulty, they can go for, you know, cesarean section or about those deliveries. But as sir also mentioned, you know, typically if it's about 8% is okay. In India and many quarters, we see that it's more than 20% or even more than that. So there is a serious problem, and the problem is not only from the part of the families or the women, but is very much from the part of the health system, particularly the Ambal centers. And so therefore, I think this study is important. The point of intergenerational transmission of good nutrition through maternal height is important. So of course, there is a very clear-cut policy address, you know, there is a need to focus on not only the shorter women, essentially those who may not have good access to food and, you know, a healthier environment. But at the same time, I think sir was making one argument, which is very important, that even among taller women, you know, when there is no, probably there is a lesser need or may not be a higher need to go for health cesarean section, still many women are going. And, you know, going through cesarean section is extremely difficult for women, right? But the way health system is being, I mean, particularly in the private sector, you know, is highly unregulated. So I think this paper is very important. And sir was talking about engaging women, which is important. At the same time, I think we should also engage and probably more the private healthcare providers, because if you choose to go to any private health facility, they will never, I mean, very rarely we see that, you know, that they would talk about normal delivery. More often than not, because of the market, because of the profit-driven provisions, we see that, you know, they articulate about making a C-section. So there is a very important message in this paper, and I congratulate authors for highlighting this issue in India. And maybe, you know, I think sir has done, I was looking at some of the interaction that sir was running with maternal height and the maternal BMI, which is very fascinating. Maybe sir, if you can also think about doing some more interactions where try to capture, for example, in NFHS, we have, you know, the place of residence, like rural, urban, have some more bifurcation, smaller cities, towns, rural, urban, and then larger cities. You know, there are 4 or 5 categories. And if you can interact that with maybe wealth or maybe education or maybe some more interaction, I think that can be more informative. Or maybe by health facility also. Maybe some interaction can bring out, maybe I'm just curious because it's so interesting, maybe it can throw some more glaring pictures of you know, where this C-section thing is going more wrong. So otherwise, I think this paper is extremely good, and the policy message is very, 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 very clearly coming out of the paper. So many congratulations to the first author, Professor Lungdim sir. Coming to the immunization paper of age-appropriate immunization in Jharkhand, I think it's very important here. Again, I say that immunization is probably one of the important investment that we can make for Indian children or children anywhere. And I think the progress that Jharkhand has made in the last 20 years, as the author was arguing, is very commendable, you know, from 10% to almost 6-fold jump. But I think this point of age appropriate immunization is very critical. And today, the funny thing is, like, we are in COVID, and we know that how immunization is anyway important to all of us. And when we get a timely immunization, I think that is best for securing the health and well-being. So I think that is very good, well done. I was looking at one of the, you know, visualization, and you were showing one graph. I think you produced through Stata, which was very good. But as a, if I'm a reviewer, maybe the graph is perfect. There is no problem with the graph. But if you can maybe, you know, sort the category in such a way, you know, that either you can arrange in ascending order or descending order, maybe make it more clear, because right now it's a little bit, you know, clumsy, because, you know, somewhere odds ratio are high, somewhere they are low. If you can try to arrange them in a sequence, maybe they will look much better. Otherwise, analysis looks very good. And I can also request, because even when we were student IAPS, you know, many times we were lost with doing so many things and often forgetting the main message. But I think you are very, very clear with that. I think throughout the presentation, you highlighted on the issue of age-appropriated immunization. So that is very good. So I wish you all the best, and I'm sure you can get a good publication of this paper. Moving on to Aparna and colleagues, paper on effect of maternal nutrition on child nutrition. I think this is again an important theme, and I applaud you for choosing different set of factors. For example, you talked about community level factor, household level factor, maternal factors, health system factor. You know, I think broadly you are choosing the UNICEF framework, which is very appreciated. And then you talk about how the maternal factors can make a lot of difference when it comes to the child anthropometry. So I think that is very good. I think you also focused on the importance of, you know, the breastfeeding at the time of delivery, which is very critical. So I think that is an important, many times people don't address this factor, but you chose to do that. I know that that is not very easy to do because the way the data is collected, recording and missing cases are there, but I think that was good. So, and you also talk about the role of anemia among mothers and then its effects on nutrition of children. So I think it's again, is a very good paper. I applaud. And finally, this paper on COVID-19, it's a review paper, but I think Dr. Sumila, you've done a very good job because, you know, there is hardly much data, particularly in Indian case. So if you can do a wonderful review and put together different themes related to adolescents or young children, because these were probably, I mean, along with elderly, right? These were some of the cohorts who were most vulnerable because they were very tender. A lot of changes physiologically and psychologically is happening in this age group. So I appreciate that the wealth of information that you could put together, it could be a very good document for, you know, referring to researchers and policymakers where they can find these various dimensions related to adolescent health. So well done, congratulations to you. So overall, I feel that the session was very productive. I had a chance to learn a lot of new things from this session. And I think when we started, Professor Unisa Mem was talking about, you know, significance of data, which in a developing country like India is very, very important. I think we all are living in an age where data is very super important. So I'm very happy, and I thank organizers, Professor Unisa Mem, Dr. Preeti Dillon, Professor, I think Reshmi Mem as well, for giving this opportunity. So ma'am, I hand it over to you. Thank you so much, and it's an honor to be here. Thank you so much.
Thank you for doing justice to your position of discussion, and you covered all the papers as well as given the comments to all the presenters. So there are 3 questions to directed to Aparna Van, Basra Van, Biswajit Basra, and Surabhi. You can see the questions. Aparna, can you see your question? Children born to mother. Yeah, if you want to reply, please reply once.
Ma'am, the results are contradicting to our view that in the earlier age group, the prevalence of malnourishment in children is high, but take it, ma'am.
That's all. Okay, thank you very much. Biswajit Basra, can you see your distinct question? Immunization improves with mother's education. Biswajit, are you around? I think he had a problem of internet.
Yes, ma'am, I can see the question. Immunization improves with mother's education, however, it is still low. What could happen? What is the follow up for children of mother's education?
Yeah, please give me if you have answer, otherwise we will skip this. Think about it, what will be the answer to this? And Surabhi, you have one question?
Yes, ma'am. Actually, I just want to say that till now, adolescent is not considered a very important age group. However, I have tried to focus that on my study. And most of the papers were focused on the prevalence of like the impact. So, and more studies were done on the mental health of adolescents, like other aspects of the adolescents, they were neglected, and there are not many studies on it. And now this is the time where when everybody is trying to assess the prevalence, assess the like the impact of the COVID-19, intervention has not yet started. Intervention, if we have to say, it is in terms of output, where NGOs have reported that they have given the facilities and the beneficiaries have availed those benefits. In terms of outcome, still research needs to be done that in this scenario, what intervention will be best suited. And of course, if it is not there, the review can also be done for the interventions for the past past I mean COVID like situations, what was effective? Because now they nobody is
okay,
in the
okay
field.
Okay, so Ravi, thank you.
Yes,
there
yes,
is a question from Professor DP Singh, please.
Yes sir.
Professor DP Singh, you can unmute yourself and ask.
Yeah, actually that Surbhi one is just fine, because I just wrote that as probably we don't have much data about impact on adolescents. So what she did, a kind of like, you know, put the other. Now, one suggestion I have to Aparna, most of her bivariate table, she gave 1%, 2%, one putting in the as it is, one putting in the bracket. Okay, so my suggestion is there, you give only 1%. Don't give the row wise also and column wise also. You should be able to understand what is the cause, what is the effect, what is the independent variable, what is the dependent variable. Because the moment you give like SPSS row column percentage, it seems that you are leaving to the reader to understand. So I think your column percentage were completely wrong, because you are trying to say that mother affects child. No, child cannot affect the mother. So the mother will be your independent, her characteristic will be the independent, like religion and all those things, which will affect the child, what is called malnutrition, like severe. A child cannot go back to mother. So you check your those percentage, and my suggestion would be that you remove those column percentage. Put your percentage as a row percentage, as a research methodology says, no? Okay, yeah.
Thank you, Professor Ding. Anybody have any other question to the presenters? Otherwise, I will give my points and conclude it. We have another session at 5:30. Okay. Let me start with Diksha. And Diksha has done a good job, and I congratulate her. But I was looking at the thing, stunting. Lot of studies are already done on stunting. There is no harm on carrying out work on stunting, but you need to think about more in it. You have to have curiosity, what else I can do in this stunting, this thing. And I was thinking, you just see those children who are born underweight, but now they are not stunted or they are not underweight. So what mother have done, what are the things they have done so the child is not underweight? Nourish. The second thing is the children who are born with normal weight, but now they are stunted. So what is wrong with them? So categorize something, do more analysis, so it will become more meaningful. Otherwise, at present, it is fine. But I feel there is a scope to improve it. The second one about association between gender inequality and this thing, Krishna. Krishnamurti, whether you have taken country as a unit or you have done region, that I was not very clear. Because if you do the country-wise this thing, first you can show the gender inequality index over the map of 150 countries. So make it interesting. People should take interest in your paper. And presentation should be in such a manner that people can understand it in within few seconds, because we, as a presenter, you will have only 10 minutes or 11 minutes or 12 minutes. So within that time frame, you should be able to communicate to the people who are participating in this thing. So I feel you need to modify your presentation. Otherwise, work-wise, fine, very good. Okay, the third one about the Professor Hame's presentation, although it is his student, first author is somebody else. But I was thinking, this is a very good analysis, but there is a scope of linking it with the maternal, obstetric morbidity. You could include those things. So those women who are, although there is no problem about the height, this thing, but maybe they have different problems during the pregnancy. They have eclampsia or some other thing or some other problems. So they have to go for the cesarean section. It's not just only height factor that will be important. Along with the height, there are some other factors. So we need to take into account all those factors. After controlling for all those factors, still the height is playing any role. Or maybe public private thing, hospital also, where it is high. So those things can also be examined. At present, I am not saying that there is something wrong, but you can expand it. You can ask your students to expand it, so it will have more meaning in that. The third, Aparna, already Dr. Deepi Singh Saab has given a suggestion to her. I feel make presentation more attractive. It should not be tables, all those things. And when you are talking about this thing, maternal nutrition and socioeconomic factors on child nutrition, you can include some beautiful graphs and presentations, so it will look good, as well as think about your analysis. There are some mismatch or something is there, just check, examine it whether it is coming significant or not. And for last presenter, so Sumila Surabhi, this is an exercise of review and concise it, put it in a different boxes, like which are the factors where you get studies, analyze it and present it in a good manner, so it can be published as a review article. With this, I do not have any more comment for anything, and whatever comments I have given for two presenters, that are my suggestions. You don't have to respond to it. Just take this as a suggestion from my side. Otherwise, Praveen has already given suggestions as well as comment on the papers. If you have any comment, response to Praveen, this thing, feel free to comment. Otherwise, we can close this session.
Just one point. Thank you, Praveen, and good to see you after a long, long time. I'm
thank
glad
you so
that
much
you're
for seeing me.
Here.
Thank you so
yeah.
much.
And yeah, you have given us a good feedback, not only on this paper, but also in others also. I hope, especially the interaction which you mentioned, we'll try to look at that. Since the concern of the student was that the height was the only or the indicator which was not mainly researched. That was his idea, that people are talking about many other things, but nobody is actually correlating this, even among the tall woman and as well as the shorter woman. You know, that was the his idea, and it is good that we will try to incorporate some other interactions. Maybe the, as you suggest, some of the availability of the data and how far it can be, we'll try to incorporate that. And also another point which I just want to mention, in case of Dixa's paper also, the idea was to look at, you know, the moment you look at the graph of the WHO with the old India, even very surprising is that even for Meghalaya, which is considered to be short stature in, but in the third and the sixth month, it was so normal, you know, there is, and then from 6 months on started giving that gap. You know, that is where the, I think we need to look more into what could be the, from the policy as well as what the women are actually doing after that, let's say roughly about 4 months onwards. After the first four months, everything is normal, the height, the growth, everything is, then suddenly we see that gap. And what she did was to filter out all those stunted women, stunted children, and then look back at what are the possibilities. I think that is, I think she will take the feedbacks in the right perspective, and we'll try to improve that also. Thank you very much. Okay.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. Thank you, everyone.
Ma'am, I just would like to conclude. Hello.
Please continue.
Hello.
Please.
Yeah. First of all, I wish to thank Professor Saidi Nisa for chairing this session. On behalf of IIPS Seminar Organizing Committee, I would like to extend our sincere thanks to Dr. Praveen Pathak for accepting this invitation and to be a part of this session in a short notice, basically. I also thank our rapporteur, Dr. Sunil Sarode, and Ms. Pragati. Ms. Pragati, PhD scholar. And I wish, I thank all the participants as well as presenters. Thank you so much. Yeah, ma'am, we will have a plenary session now.
Yeah, close, ask them to close.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you all. Bye. Yeah.
Thank you. Bye, sir.